Hi, I'm a Western game developer, and apparently that means I really hate Elden Ring. Just thinking about it makes me unable to see straight. I'm just fuming over how it disproves everything that I learned about game development. So much so that I played it for over 200 hours and got the Platinum Trophy. Damn you, FromSoft! FromSoft! Okay. I have to admit that this is a bit of a cheap shot. Video titles and headlines need to be pithy and attention-grabbing, so a more accurate title like "A Few Western Game Developers Criticize Some Aspects of Elden Ring" just isn't going to get those clicks. Look, I get it. As a fellow creator, I'm probably going to make a provocative thumbnail for this video myself. So what exactly am I doing here? Well, this is a bit of a break from my usual content. In fact, this video is flying in the face of the one rule that I had when I started this channel. No response videos! So yeah, this ain't my vibe. I already have a lengthy backlog of topics that I want to talk about, and I feel reacting to others' takes is just going to derail those efforts. So maybe make this a once a year stipulation. I haven't decided if that's 365 days from now or if that resets on January 1st, but whatever. Right now, I'm going to have a little response video as a treat. What I want to respond to is a narrative that's caught on in discussions of Elden Ring that I find to be, well, a bit troubling. This narrative's core notion is that Elden Ring's success is owed to being a quote-unquote Japanese game that rejects Western game design conventions. And frequently, this is emphasized by comparing Elden Ring to its contemporary, Horizon Forbidden West. Now, since I'm going to all these lengths of creating a response video, it might be somewhat surprising for me to say, I actually agree with this sentiment? Sorta. For a long while, something has always rubbed me the wrong way about most Western AAA titles, especially those of the open-world genre. I've never found Assassin's Creed or the other Ubisoft-style open worlds all that appealing. I immediately checked out of Arkham City, even though I loved Arkham Asylum. And even though it was not made by a Western dev team, I even bounced off the widely beloved Breath of the Wild after a couple of hours. The only open worlds that I've found myself thoroughly engrossed in were Burnout Paradise and, well, you're going to have to keep watching this video to find out. Go ahead and make your guesses in the comments section now. But suffice to say, someone who grew up as part of Generation SNES, and who subsequently has a lot of favorite games made by Japanese teams, I do wonder if my love for Elden Ring is in part due to how my tastes were shaped by Japanese game design, if such a thing exists. So then, what's my beef with the notion that Elden Ring debunks Western game design? Well, the devil is in the details, and as internet discourse usually goes, these details have been steamrolled to fit into this crude narrative. What remains has a kernel of truth, but that actually makes it more insidious, because there's quite a few misconceptions, generalizations, and other faulty reasonings that are coming along for the ride here. I realize that I'm more than a few months late to the party here, but unfortunately, I feel like this East versus West notion has taken root and become a sort of unchallenged truism for many people. And I feel like I have the life experience to add some depth and consideration to the discourse here. So this is going to be my attempt to set things right, as it were. Hello? My name is Hell Dupay. I've been working professionally as a game developer for over 6 years now, and this is Infernal Ramblings. Let's nuance. So in order to sort out what parts of this narrative have merit and which ones don't, let's take a closer look and break it down into its component premises. Premises? Elden Ring and Horizon Forbidden West are both open-world action RPG contemporaries and therefore can be directly compared to one another. Two, Elden Ring is a commercial success and Horizon Forbidden West is not. 3, the reason Elden Ring succeeded is largely due to it rejecting conventions for a AAA open world game. Its quest design, reward philosophy, UI, tutorials, etc. 4, these differences come from an essential difference in culture between Japanese and Western game developers. 5, ergo, Elden Ring disproves Western game design dogma. This is why Western developers are furious and jealous or are otherwise upset with Elden Ring's success. Oh, and of course, I'm going to use footage that flatters me in this video. If you want to see the blooper reel, stick around until the end. So let's examine this first premise here. At first blush, this seems like a straightforward comparison to make. They're both action RPGs featuring open worlds and third-person perspectives. They both have considerable narrative elements that tell stories with global existential stakes. They were released a week apart. Based on these aspects, it's easy to see why folks might think they're comparing apples to apples. But when we zoom in on these aspects, does it really make much sense to compare these two games to one another? Both games put a lot of effort into telling grandiose stories, but you can say the same thing of, for example, a romance novel and a horror movie. In this case, Horizon is a post-apocalyptic science fiction set in the future of our world, mixing tribal aesthetics with high technology. Just look at those robot dinosaurs. They're like one of my childhood fever dreams come to life on the screen. Elden Ring takes place in a fictionally constructed fantasy world, steeped in intrigue and full of, sometimes quite literally, larger-than-life figures, infusing standard sword and sorcery imagery with cosmic mysticism. And also giant lobsters. And not only do these two games starkly differ in their worlds and narratives, but in how they approach and present them. Let's move on to our player protagonists. In Elden Ring, the Tarnished is an empty vessel, a completely detached and independent entity at the start of the story. Aloy, on the other hand, is an established character with an existing backstory and relationships in the world. Elden Ring's story tends to focus more on its NPCs and the aftermath of their past actions, where it's up to the player to piece together the scattered clues and make sense of the bigger picture themselves. The Tarnished story centers around the resolution of this catastrophe, a sort of epilogue for this saga, with the player deciding how or whether to mend the shattered Elden Ring. Meanwhile, Forbidden West finds Aloy as a key player in its central conflict and is much more directed in its story reveals and ending. Now let's take a look at gameplay. So both Elden and Horizon are open-world action RPGs. Does this mean they have the same goals in mind in terms of player experience? This is where I have a major axe to grind with the small set of limited and vague genres we lump video games into. That'll be a future video. For instance, Halo Combat Evolved and Metroid Prime are both sci-fi first-person shooters released about a year apart. But we can all agree that those two games play very differently and invoke dissimilar moods, correct? Both Elden and Horizon use a third-person perspective. Sure, both games contain RPG elements. Both games have combat-oriented action, but are not straight-ahead action games, tending to encourage a degree of caution. If you rush in hacking and slashing, you're probably in for a rough time in both games. But the ways each game fosters this wariness diverge considerably. Horizon emphasizes sniper-like tactics, prioritizing stealth and accurately hitting enemies' weak points as the keys to success. You can certainly employ stealth in Elden as well, but the overall feel is more akin to a fighting game with its dodging, blocking, and countering. Or in other words, Horizon stresses spatiality with precision shooting while staying concealed, but Elden is much more temporally focused, concentrating more on recognizing openings and getting the timing down. The degree to which these two games inspire trepidation in their players also differs wildly. Elden Ring carries on the notorious From Software tradition for creating spaces that act as a sort of additional adversary for the player, using pitfalls, traps, and other environmental hazards to my frequent demise. Okay, you can get one blooper right now. I think it's safe to say that Horizon's environments are nowhere near as hostile. I could mention how Elden has multiplayer and multiple endings, which Horizon lacks, or that it follows the Souls-like pattern, a better categorization than most genres, but still a bit clumsy, where Horizon doesn't, so on and so on. But I hope I don't need to belabor the point too much more here. Despite superficial similarities, these two games are considerably different in how they play and who they appeal to. And sure, there will be the gamers out there who play both, but I think we have good reason to believe that this particular Venn diagram is far from a circle. And with that, I will argue that comparing these two games in such a manner is dubious and uncritical at best, if not outright faulty. Let's move on to the next premise. Elden Ring is a commercial success, and Horizon Forbidden West is not. There's no disputing that Elden Ring is one of the most successful video games of the year, selling 13.4 million copies according to a report in May 2022 by its publisher, Bandai Namco. Forbidden West released a week before Elden Ring, when it enjoyed the second biggest PS5 launch to date, behind Spider-Man Miles Morales, and was top of the sales charts that week. Sequel sales were reportedly 35% less than its predecessor. However, this number did not include digital downloads. Given the fact that many PS5s are digital only, and that digital sales have become far more popular over the past 5 years, I doubt marketing and sales departments at Sony lost any sleep over this. Now, Horizon sales did drop considerably in the following week when Elden Ring entered the scene. And this is where the narrative starts to pick up that Forbidden West has been a commercial failure for Sony and Guerrilla Games. Part of this thinking is rooted in the rather silly idea that only the top-selling game of the time is the winner, and everything else being losers by comparison. It is still very much in the realm of possibility that a game can meet or exceed its sales goals, even if another game sells more copies. This raises the question, what makes a video game commercially successful? As someone who is decidedly not a fan of capitalism, I would say that any game that sells at least enough to break even on production costs, accounting for inflation, is a success, but that's just me. Now, it's hard to gauge this for Forbidden West because Sony hasn't released official sales figures yet, and the only figure I see with regards to its production expenses comes from an unsourced IMDb trivia comment, so take it with a dump truck of salt. That said, the over 110 million euro budget mentioned seems reasonable enough. Let's adjust upwards to 115 million US dollars, taking into account conversion rate as well as some fudge factor as well. How many PS5 digital sales does it take to reach 115 million dollars? Considering that Sony is the publisher and owns the storefront, I'm going to say that it gets almost all of the original $70 price tag per sale in this case. With that in mind, Forbidden West would only need to sell just over 1.5 million copies to break even, which I'm going to go out on a limb here and say that it met pretty easily. For reference, the aforementioned Spider-Man Miles Morales has sold 33 million copies as of May 2022. So even if Elden Ring outsold Horizon greatly, and I'm not convinced it did, Forbidden West would still be profitable to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars with a modest sales figure like, say, 5 million copies. Now sure, the capitalists bankrolling it may turn up their noses because it wasn't profitable enough, but then again, an economic system which demands infinite growth on a planet with finite resources and finite markets may not be the best idea either. But I digress. And while launch time and the weeks following are where a video game makes most of its money, both of these games have been out for about 8 months by the time I finish writing and recording this, and one benefit of being late to the discourse party is that I have hindsight at my disposal here. And in this case, Forbidden West has enjoyed an uptick in sales since its launch, in large part due to being bundled with the PS5. At the time of writing, these bundles are still $50 more than the base console, which matches the current retail price of Forbidden West, and, wouldn't you know it, Elden Ring as well. I don't think Sony would be drawing up and manufacturing this custom packaging for a game that was supposedly an abject sales disaster, and they certainly wouldn't be charging extra for the bundle if it were. I know this because I got the collector's edition of The Order 1886 for absolutely free when I bought my PS4. They just threw it in for free, literally. That's what trying to unload unwanted merchandise looks like. Forbidden West's release also brought about a spike in sales for Horizon Zero Dawn. I think it's reasonable to surmise that many players may now just be getting to Forbidden West after completing the first game. Or perhaps they've come back to it now given the steep decline in Elden Ring's concurrent user numbers and the lack of big releases since these two games came out. Now, I know the next God of War is probably going to come out before I finish recording this, so yeah, look, it's tough trying to do this video stuff while also working a full-time job, okay? Now, I get that our engagement-driven social media landscape demands hyperbole, but it is completely unfounded to declare Horizon Forbidden West a commercial failure, even when compared to its wildly successful contemporary Elden Ring. We've got another spurious premise here. So I've established that it's a bit ridiculous to be comparing Elden Ring and Horizon Forbidden West just because they're both open-world RPGs, and that rumors of Forbidden West's demise have been greatly overstated. This narrative appears to be built on a rapidly crumbling foundation, but we can still move ahead with the third premise. So why did Elden Ring become such a smash hit? Well, I do think its approach to the open-world format is part of that, but I think there is a much more immediate factor in its commercial success. Hype. Elden Ring had hype in spades. First, it was the latest release from From Software, a studio with a reputation for quality games, and one which has accumulated a sizable cult following over the years. From Software is also the origin of, and thus seen as the authority on, the burgeoning Souls-like style. Elden Ring was a brand new IP, granting an opportunity for newcomers to get in on the ground floor and to see what all this fuss was about. Elden Ring was also a collaboration with the author of the biggest pop culture fantasy franchise of the past 10 years, and surely some folks were curious about what he was doing here instead of finishing The Winds of Winter, myself included. Get back to work, George! It also won the most anticipated game title at each of the game advertisements. The Game Awards, since its announced trailer in 2019. I don't know about you, but that strikes me as an astronomical amount of hype that few games ever receive. So much so that Elden Ring was guaranteed to have a fantastic launch and plenty of social media buzz for the weeks following, no matter the quality of the game itself. But the game was also just good. Damn good, in my opinion. Just a hair below Bloodborne as my favorite From Software game. And while I think this particular premise is a case of many people using objective quantitative values such as sales figures to justify their personal qualitative assessments, there is a kernel of truth here. Elden Ring kicks ass, and the reason it kicks ass is a significant factor in its success from where I sit. And yes, I do believe the big reason why Elden Ring kicks ass is that it provides a unique take on the open world format without a lot of the trappings of conventional AAA open world RPG design. Reminds me of my previously favorite open world RPG setting, which I deliberately withheld naming earlier, so... drumroll please, it's Final Fantasy VI. Yet again, as I am wont to do on this channel, I'm talking about Final Fantasy VI. And yes, the World of Ruin, otherwise known as the back half of the game, is constructed as what we would now call an open world. There are only three main path quests that are needed to complete the game. First is recruiting Edgar to gain access to Kalingan, then doing Setzer's quest to get the airship, then defeating Kefka. Everything else is optional, though it's going to be tough to beat Kefka's tower with just three low-level characters. And playing through Elden Ring, I began to realize that I was enjoying it for many of the same reasons that I love Final Fantasy VI's World of Ruin. Combining open-world structure with what I'm going to call opaque quest design makes the game feel like a scavenger hunt without a list. And when side content awards unique items and abilities instead of, say, some amount of a generic fungible currency, it creates this really cool feeling of deck building. And I do believe that the way Elden Ring merges this quote-unquote newer open world concept with quote-unquote older questing and reward philosophies does illustrate some flaws in the prevailing set of conventions in AAA open world games. And I want to emphasize the word set there. Also, just a real quick aside, I hate the terms new and old when describing game design practices. We will get back to this in a bit. The fact that most open world games have never resonated with me is somewhat confounding. Using Bartle's taxonomy, which is admittedly a bit incomplete, you might think that I'm an achiever because I got the platinum trophy for this game. But I've only ever gotten like 5 platinum trophies ever. And when I do, it's a sign that I really like a game, and I obviously loved Elden Ring. In truth, the explorer playstyle is the one that I most align with. So what does Elden Ring get right about exploration that conventional open world games don't? What Elden Ring and Final Fantasy VI have shown me is that the open world concept alone is not at fault here. What I find is that there are 2 game design philosophies that are frequently employed in tandem with open worlds that, unfortunately, result in an unsavory experience for me. The first is the notion that quantity has a quality of its own. Or, to put it another way, it's the more is more principle. It's the belief that a game is better the longer it holds a player's attention. Ergo, more content is always more desirable over less content. Or to put it even more succinctly, it values playtime above all else. The second philosophy is that anything that might frustrate the player must be avoided at all costs. And I think this one is pretty straightforward. We play games to have fun, and any annoyance or hindrance runs counter to this. So just get rid of those things that frustrate the player. Problem solved. Both of these drives are rooted in a well-meaning but, in my opinion, ultimately misguided ideology about how to improve games, at least in this context. I know we've piled up a lot of topics to address later already, but stick a pin in this one as well. The problem I have does not emerge when you examine these elements in isolation. All of them are quite defensible on their own. It's the confluence of this open world concept with these 2 philosophies that produces the issue. So let's first talk about quest design. I describe the quests of Elden Ring as opaque. What this means is that practically everything about the quests are hidden from the player. There's no non-diegetic signposting showing where quests are, no obvious tells that an NPC is a quest giver. The way to advance a quest is frequently cryptic or obscure, and no way to know ahead of time what the outcome or reward of the quest will be. All of these things can potentially lead to player frustration, and so the conventional approach, seen in most AAA games, does the exact opposite for all these aspects. These are what I would dub transparent quests, where all sorts of information are readily available to the player, where to find them, what they involve, how to complete them, and what their payoff is. In a vacuum, this approach makes a great deal of sense. If the player wants to find a quest, their options shouldn't just be to either brute force search the game world or consult an out-of-game resource to direct them toward the next objective. They should know upfront what the reward is and what sort of gameplay the quest entails, so they don't waste time on something that doesn't help or interest them. And let's suppose the player has to step away from the game and doesn't come back for a few days, weeks, months. Then it's quite helpful to have frequent signposts and logs that can catch them up to speed when they return. In theory, combining these transparent quests with open world design should function like a buffet. All the assorted content is splayed out for all to see. For completionists, it makes little difference. They're going to do everything anyway. Critical Path players can do their own thing as well, with some optional buffs available from side content if they need it. So with 2 ends of the spectrum satisfied, one might think that the buffet approach might appeal to everyone. The problem, of course, is that there is more than one axis upon which to evaluate the structure of a game. And this buffet, which supposedly has something for everyone, is ironically lacking the key element that motivates us explorers to play. Surprise.
Surprise!
Oh!
One area Elden Ring differs obviously from conventional open-world design is in the way it rewards players. In a typical open world, the benefit for doing optional content is usually some form of currency, improvement points, fungible upgrade materials, etc., that the player can readily exchange for any skill or improvement they want. Elden instead frequently gives unexchangeable prizes for beating side bosses in dungeons, unique armor, weapons, spells, and so on. I conceptualize this as a deck-building exercise, where we're drawing a random card to add to our pool of options. This in turn creates an erratic reward schedule. For instance, I was playing a Faith build for most of my Elden Ring playthrough, so frequently the reward was a spell or weapon that I either didn't want or couldn't use. But when it was an incantation or something that enhanced my build, it was a fun and delightful surprise. If you've dipped your toe into the psychology of game design, this erratic reward schedule will probably conjure up the concept of the Skinner box. Basically, randomizing the intervals between rewards is an effective way to condition a behavior. And boy howdy, it did the trick on me. I tracked down just about everything in this game. I did all the catacomb dungeons, I fought all the overworld bosses, I even hunted down some of the rarer drops in the game. That may say more about my propensity for compulsive behavior, however, but rewarding the player with something that might not be useful to them is obviously going to cause some frustration. Coming back to conventional design, it would suggest giving the player what they want. And if that's too large of a reward for the content in question, you give them a form of currency they can use to unlock that thing once they save up enough. This is why skill trees and tech points have become so common. But what this resolves in frustration comes at the cost of novelty. While the player may now be able to anticipate and get excited for a future ability, gone are the elements of mystery and surprise. And while it can be frustrating to get an item that is useless to your character's build, there are few things more delightful than receiving something you didn't even know you wanted. Several times throughout Elden Ring, I would come across a new incantation or weapon that took my build to the next level, or provided some sort of fun gimmick that I could potentially incorporate into my playstyle. And since I wasn't expecting these upgrades, they felt all the more wondrous to me. Let's come back to how Elden Ring's opaque quest design factors into this bigger picture. It's quite easy, through actions that seem quite innocuous like talking to an NPC, to start a quest. And once on that path, the next action to advance the quest is usually not fully articulated in any way, and in very rare instances do they receive something like a map marker. When making a critical decision in a questline, the player is frequently operating with incomplete information, making it quite unclear what exactly they might be doing and what the consequences will be. This enhances Elden Ring's mystique, and it rewards players for their diligence and attentiveness. The obfuscating ambiguity of these quests also disempower the player, reinforcing the narrative that the Tarnish is being manipulated by the assorted power brokers of the Lands Between. But this opacity doesn't always work, and sometimes just feels obtuse. For instance, I had no clue to look for Nepheli Lu down here at Roundtable Hold if the Fextralife guide didn't mention it. But this quest design does surprise and delight frequently enough, in my opinion. And these contrasting approaches can create starkly different moods with regard to an open world. In Elden Ring, I feel like there's always something earth-shattering around each corner, either a bit of lore that recontextualizes the grand mystery of the story, or a new ability or piece of gear that is going to radically alter my playstyle. By contrast, I feel like the conventional AAA open-world RPG tips its hand way too early in an effort to mitigate player frustration, and now instead of uncovering a mystery, am now playing out the string, as it were. I do want to take a moment here and clarify something. My personal value judgment, based on what I prefer in my video games, clearly favors Elden Ring's approach here. But does that mean it's better? It appeals more to me, sure. And as the world's best and most infallibly objective critic, obviously that means it's superior to the other approach. Clearly, no room for dispute here. Or maybe, as I brought up in the previous section, Elden Ring and the generic open world RPG we've been comparing it to in this section are trying to achieve different goals. And trying to compare them directly is, well, kind of silly. I brought this up with a friend, and he mentioned that while he found Elden Ring to be a great experience, it was a bit too demanding for him. You see, he was looking for a game that could help him unwind after a day of work, and the more conventional open-world approach of Horizon Forbidden West was just what he was looking for. And I must confess that I've looked down my nose at such games in the past. But if I step outside of myself for a bit, I have to recognize the value in something that can let people unplug their frontal lobes for a little bit. Our modern world demands a lot of critical thinking and tough decisions during our waking hours, which, unfortunately, are quite frequently also our working hours. Again, maybe capitalism just sucks. I may deride such games as checklist simulators, but as millions of sales for games like Assassin's Creed show, there's obviously a market for entertainment that is not quite so engaging critically. And I think that's great, personally. Different strokes for different folks, as it goes. Not everything can be, or needs to be, a delicacy demanding some sort of refined palate. Sometimes the crowd-pleasing comfort food hits the spot just as well, if not better. That having been said, I do think Elden Ring is one such delicacy. Now, mind you, that's not to say that it's without flaws, because it certainly has flaws, but you're going to have to stick around a little bit longer before I get into them. First, I want to address the elephant in the room. Premise number 4, these differences come from an essential difference in culture between Japanese and Western game developers. I'm going to come out and say that I really know next to nothing about Japanese culture. I've never been to Japan and have never been immersed in that culture. And even if I did, me being a white Westerner would assuredly color and distort my perspective. I'm just another idiot on the internet who has consumed my fair share of a tiny subset of Japanese pop culture. Or, in other words, I am horrendously unqualified to make any kind of commentary on Japan, its people, and its prevailing culture. But I think we can cast aspersions on this premise without a detailed cultural comparison between Japan and the United States or the EU or whatever. Because the heart of this premise, as I've seen so many people on Twitter regurgitate, is that the differences between Elden Ring and, say, Ubisoft open worlds must essentially come from this contrast of cultures. Now, yes, consider the source. People say all sorts of ridiculous things on Twitter all day, every day. But this premise right here is the main reason why I'm making this video, because it's some nonsense. Now, can cultural influences be a factor in why From Software made these design decisions creating Elden Ring? Certainly. My complaint is that way too many people are treating this supposed difference of culture as necessary for these decisions. And that, my friends, reeks a lot of Orientalism, stereotyping people of the Middle East and Asia as somehow mystically different from the rest of humanity, when they're just, you know, human beings like you and me. So yeah, that sucks and should give anyone pause when considering such a notion. But also, we know that these differences in open-world game design aren't necessitated by cultural differences. There's a reason why I brought up channel favorite Final Fantasy VI here, because it's one of the most well-regarded Japanese RPGs of all time. And although Elden Ring strays quite far away from the conventions of JRPGs, it's very clear that From Software draws at least some water from that well. Wait, am I just making the cultural argument again? Well, no. Because if you know the history of Final Fantasy, you know that one of its primary influences is a little-known American game franchise called
Dungeons and Dragons.
The supposedly Japanese game design conventions that made Elden Ring distinct were informed by Western games all along. It's almost like this entire premise and the cultural essentialism it's built upon is just complete silly season nonsense.
This man is overgasped!
So why are so many people latching onto this? Well, I'm going to get a bit more speculative here. There seems to be a strong desire within a certain portion of the Western video game fandom that is eager to venerate Japanese developers for some reason. It's almost like these gamers fall into a very black and white reasoning, or perhaps seem to think that a show of dominance is equal to a sign of moral superiority. Thus, these Japanese developers are but a weapon in their culture war against the dreaded wokeness monster, That is, the social and cultural sensibilities that all Western game developers supposedly share. I wish. You see, Elden Ring completely destroying and humiliating Horizon Forbidden West, which again didn't happen, by the way, is a clear signal, again not really, that the gaming public reject Western game developers' attempts at inclusivity by still buying millions of copies of these woke games somehow. It's so obvious that these Japanese devs are on their side, ignoring of course that many of them have strong political beliefs that are completely opposed to the narratives being spun here. And the fact that Elden Ring sold a few million more copies over an incredibly profitable Horizon Forbidden West is an omen that this anti-woke worldview is the right one. Because we all know sales are a clear indicator of quality. An inferior product never ever outsells a better one. And popularity is clearly the true and undisputed measure of goodness and righteousness and high taste. That's why Nickelback is one of the greatest rock bands of the 21st century. I mean, the mental gymnastics here are spinning so fast they're getting the twisties. This is a hurricane of nonsense. But I guess it seems normal if you're the type of person who gets angry that some games these days don't treat all their women characters like sex objects, or show that trans people exist, or prominently feature a character of color. Just extremely normal things to get upset about, totally not weird or creepy behavior in the slightest. And what I find so amusing about all of this is that these were the same type of guys 10 years ago who were saying stuff like, no one wants to play Japanese games because they're for... Y'all ain't slick. That you're so utterly shameless to use Japanese developers as props for your bigotry is completely disgraceful. Stop. Get some help. So, obviously, when a few Western developers made some criticisms of Elden Ring, these very calm and extremely rational fans carefully considered this developer feedback and engaged in a thoughtful dialogue about it. At long last, we come to our final premise. Number 5. Ergo, Elden Ring disproves Western game design dogma. This is why Western developers are furious and jealous, or are otherwise upset at Elden Ring's success. Listen, I know the corkboard here is full, but we're going to have to come back to that first sentence, which I kind of agree with for what it's worth, in a little bit. But are Western developers really angry or envious at Elden Ring's success? No. Thanks for watching. Be sure to like, comment, and subscribe. My next video is about... Okay, wait. There's a lot to discuss here, actually. I'm a Western developer, so am I jealous of Elden Ring's success? Well, I would love to work on a project like Elden Ring, for sure. It's a great game, and time will tell if it's a true classic, but I like its odds. By all means, I think it's earned its success. And yeah, it'd be really awesome to have my name on a game like that. But this really isn't jealousy, now is it? So let's get to the tweets in question, the ones that supposedly show that every single last one of us Western developers loathe Elden Ring because it breaks every single rule that we were taught in game school. Man, this must have been an epic meltdown. These folks must have been absolutely seething. Oh. Just a few people saying the UI sucks or making some other pretty reasonable critiques. This is what is getting content mined and blown out of proportion by trashy clickbait videos to the tune of 1.4 million views. And amid all this nonsense, everyone is ignoring that these devs are, you know, kind of right in their criticisms. My siblings in America, or Radigan.
Gender is made up, be whoever you want to be, go wild.
I want you all to understand that people can make criticisms from a pretty dispassionate place. There's no malice to these words. They're looking at an aspect of a game and commenting on how it could be done more efficiently or more elegantly. Can we please just stop getting ridiculously defensive over stuff we like and maybe, just maybe, admit that it has some flaws and that's okay? I know, that's a tall ask. But we game developers deliver this sort of feedback amongst each other on a regular basis, and if we all took such criticisms personally, the game development space would be dysfunctional. Well, more dysfunctional than it already is, but you get my point. I want people to understand that many times criticism is not trying to smear or undermine what it's criticizing, but rather to point out how it can be better. It is the opposite of spite. We game devs deliver such critiques because we want to see our team and fellow devs make the best game possible. We do this because we care. I played Elden Ring for over 200 hours. I got the Platinum Trophy. I even farmed out rare drops like the Gelmir Glintstone Staff and the Monk's Flame Blade.
Which is actually pretty unremarkable outside of its novelty, like literally just one enemy, not enemy type, literally just exactly one mob in this massive game world has this weapon, like a 4% drop rate, it's not even that great a weapon, but I still got it anyway.
Needless to say, I really love this game. And so when I say what I'm about to say, I want you to keep that in mind and maybe hold back your reflexive response, okay? Elden Ring's UI sucks. Yeah, sorry, there's no way around that. Let me give you a few examples. First off, if I don't have enough golden seeds to upgrade my total number of flasks, why is this option still selectable? Yeah, I get that From Software games, you know, try to reward players who are paying attention and kind of remember things like this, but what is gained here by allowing me to select this option, and then the game comes back a second later and tells me that I don't have enough golden seeds? It could just tell me that by graying out this menu option, and you could still make the argument that the game is forcing me to remember to go into this menu and check it. It could still do this by having a little indicator showing the number of golden seeds I currently have versus the number needed for an upgrade. Nothing is gained by the way it's currently set up in the game. Instead, it wastes my time to go into this menu and to brute force check if I have enough materials for the next upgrade. This sucks. And hey, if you're like me and collected practically every piece of equipment in the game, you're struck with how unwieldy this menu is when you have all this crap. I know some people are going to take this critique and extrapolate it into something completely different, like I'm somehow asking for an optimized button on my gear. Jesus Christ, folks, adding a filter or sorting mechanism on the inventory screen isn't going to ruin the Souls-like concept or baby the player in any way. Tedium is not the same as difficulty, and also, while we're here, these games are not good because they're difficult. They're challenging and engaging for sure, but one of these days I'm going to dig into this grander narrative that the Souls game main draw is how hard they are. But alas, that's another video. Also, it would not disrupt the Souls-like experience at all to have some sort of log function here. You know, these games have a habit of putting loot in enticing spots to lure players into a trap. That's cool. I actually like that design a lot. But that means that it's pretty common for players to grab loot in a frenzy and then they have to dismiss the UI before they see whatever it is they picked up. And now they have to hunt through the aforementioned behemoth of an inventory screen to track down what the heck they just picked up. I don't know about you, but that's not really enhancing my experience in any way. Just give us a log that shows us, like, what we've recently picked up or what NPCs have said to us recently. I'm not asking for hand-holdy signposts to the next objective, I'm just asking for knowledge my character has already acquired to be recorded in a way that I can go back and readily look at it in the game. Instead of having to consult the Fextra Life page to remember where the hell I am in this particular quest chain. We can acknowledge that Elden Ring is a fantastic game with awful UI, yes? And that brings me back to the first sentence of this premise. While none of these Western game devs on Twitter are saying that Elden Ring doesn't deserve its success because it failed some usability testing guideline, there are certain attitudes in Western game development that do border on a sort of orthodoxy. And in many ways, Elden Ring is refreshing in the ways that it disrupts and challenges the received wisdom of this orthodoxy. For one, let's come back to the concept of opaque quests. There are many game developers out there that believe that because certain game design approaches were born out of technical limitations we've overcome as an industry, that said approaches are old or outdated. This is instead of evaluating these approaches on their own merits or how they make use of said limitations. I feel like this is a case for Elden Ring's opaque quests. Yes, they are very similar to the quests of an older game like Final Fantasy VI, where quest logs and UI signposts were simply out of scope for the technology of the time. But without these sorts of indicators, opaque quests force us to engage more intentionally with the environment. A random villager might make mention of a curious location in passing, and if we're paying attention and follow up on that, we get a sense of reward that more modern transparent quests lack. I hope I'm making it very clear that I find this concept that certain game designs are obsolete to be ridiculous. I recall a time in game school where a classmate told me he didn't like Chrono Trigger because he felt the turn-based combat was outdated. And then, like, half an hour later, I saw him playing Hearthstone. A lot of this comes from a mindset that has some pretty strong roots in game development, especially, but not exclusively, here in America. I would call this the consumer software product mindset. With big budget video game production now requiring years of work done by hundreds of developers, it makes sense that many companies have imported methodologies from existing corporate software development practices. Let's just say that it's not a coincidence that this mindset became much more prevalent after Microsoft entered the home console market. Before I go off on why this philosophy is ultimately counterproductive, I want to say that this approach has brought in a decent amount of improvements into how we make and play games today. The focus on UI and UX in particular has greatly improved interfaces in games and the overall quality of life for players. But I do think there is a certain absolutism that comes with some of these techniques. In particular, there's a belief in an industry standard that must be met, and if a game fails to do so, it is an objective failure. Maybe this is so obvious that it doesn't need to be said, but games are not consumer software products. Yes, if a website requires 10 clicks to do anything, most users are going to get confused, frustrated, or likely to bounce off and go somewhere else. But I believe people are more than willing to make some affordances for a really entertaining game. Yeah, okay, the user interface is kinda clunky, but that's a really minor annoyance that I'm willing to overlook because I'm having so much fun otherwise. This is the fundamental flaw in the consumer software product mindset around games. We're not trying to create a better Photoshop or a sleeker and easier to use version of Excel. Practically all consumer software products can be described as a tool for doing blank. But a video game is not a tool for doing fun or a tool for doing entertainment. Approaching them in this manner is a foundational error, one that greatly misunderstands what a game is. Games are creative works rooted in playfulness, and the consumer software product mentality is anathema to that. Shirking the supposed rules and using things outside of their intended purposes are some ways to be playful, and I think this touches upon why Elden Ring was so successful. So many open-world RPGs out there are made with this consumer software product ideology, that if they just do the same things better, or provide more content, or have newer, shinier graphics, then they are bound to be a huge success over their predecessors. And this is why AAA games in general have started to feel so homogenous and beholden to trends. So when something like Elden Ring comes along that disregards so many of these conventions, we're reminded that we're playing a game, not a piece of software. And for the love of all that is good and holy, this is not something essential to Western culture. I see so many vapid comments about how Japanese developers are winning over gamers by avoiding the quote-unquote cynical practices of Western game studios like microtransactions, loot boxes, and the like. You folks do realize that many Japanese developers also make gacha games, which are some of the most cynical and microtransaction-y products one will ever come across. I know everyone's forgotten about it already, but the now-not-so-live service Babylon's Fall was brought to us by a once-esteemed Japanese studio under the direction of a Japanese-based mega publisher. Stop this cultural essentialism nonsense, please. What you really hate is capitalism. The source of all you find to be wrong in these games these days comes from this wrong-headed capitalist pursuit for infinite growth in a finite system. Capitalism drives the consumer software product mindset. Capitalism demands predatory monetization. Capitalism is what's undervaluing and exploiting the skilled creators of your favorite games. And by constantly focusing on this developer drama and other culture war BS, you're just distracting from all of this. It's a false consciousness that keeps you from seeing the real enemy here. And I know it's standard procedure on Twitter to read anything anyone says in the most uncharitable way, bulldozing any sort of nuance and creating this sort of phony, manufactured outrage. I mean, that's what the platform is designed to do, engagement uber alles after all. But can we just not do that? We so-called Western developers are not your enemies. The vast majority of us are in complete agreement that capitalism is destroying games and, well, everything, to be honest. Just like you, we want to play good games. We want to make those games. We have a common foe here, the capitalist class who want to turn games into jobs and products. Look no further than Square Enix president Yosuke Matsuda's mask-off moment earlier in the year.
I realize that some people who quote-unquote play to have fun, and who currently form the majority of players, have voiced their reservations towards these new trends, and understandably so. However, I believe that there will be a certain number of people whose motivation is to quote-unquote play to contribute, by which I mean to help make the game more exciting. Traditional gaming has offered no explicit incentive to this latter group of people, who are motivated strictly by such inconsistent personal feelings as goodwill and volunteer spirit.
And hey, if I have the ear of any fellow developers here, can we cut back on the snark and condescension toward the people who play our games? We weren't born with this arcane game development knowledge, and getting all elitist about it is just kind of a bad look. But okay, you can drag the dudes on Reddit who seem to think that you can push a button and like 2 hours later the game magically has a multiplayer mode, but you know, try to limit the clowning to such Dunning-Kruger masters. We should lead with empathy otherwise. At the very least, I hope that I've shown that this ridiculous East versus West discourse around Elden Ring and Horizon Forbidden West is littered with all manner of bad faith and, let's just say, specious reasoning. It's traveled far and taken root because there is a kernel of truth within all its overblown sensationalist nonsense, but again, that's why it's such an insidious lie. All I'm asking of you is to be wary and more scrutinous whenever the next round of video game discourse comes around. Thanks for watching.
But I'm not done yet!
Over the second rafter, off the floor, down to the net.
Nobody ever suspects the butterfly.
Double KO!
not in my heart.
I'm gonna make it! This is the greatest thrill of my life! I'm king of the world!
Woohoo! Woohoo!
Oh!